Good evening, everyone. Thank you to the Deputy Vice Chancellor Danny Fisser and Deputy Vice Chancellor Kloppers. Thank you to the Dean of Science Professor Peru for that kind introduction. I'd like to thank especially a number of people who've made a very long trip to be with me at this special occasion. That is Professor John Brady from Cornell University, Dr. Jürgen Schnittke, who traveled all the way from California, Professor Fritz Schaefer from the University of Georgia, Professor Gernot Franken from Marburg University in Germany, and Professor Kunle Olukontan from Stanford University. We just lost some connection there, which I hope will reset. I'd also like to thank my family and friends for joining me and for the university for affording me this opportunity to tell you a little bit about my science and my thoughts on science. I'll be speaking to you about three revolutions tonight. As advertised, I will speak to you about the computational revolution. but I will also speak to you about the revolution that has brought about the way we do science. And I would also like to speak to you about a very new revolution, one that is happening in molecular biology and in chemical biology, and that is the birth of a field called glycobiology or chemical glycobiology. I will focus my talk in computational sciences mainly on chemistry and chemical biology because that's what's advertised, but this field has grown across all of sciences and it certainly has even made its way across campus into the social sciences. Particularly in the field of economics, and I'm very pleased to see that my son has joined me here all the way from the University of Chicago via Skype. So welcome, Jesse. In about 1600, up until 1600, the way people thought about science, and certainly the aristocracy were the most active players in understanding the natural world, is that they made an observation, and they, after that observation, they had vigorous discussion, lots of arguments. And after those arguments, facts would ascend from those arguments. And a chief proponent of this method, and those people were referred to as natural philosophers, was Thomas Hobbes. Thomas Hobbes was a mathematician, and he was a big defender of this way of doing what was then known interrogation of nature or natural philosophy. So you can imagine his absolute dismay and the dismay of all the natural philosophers when the young Robert Boyle came along. And Boyle was no one of diminished stature. He was the son of the Earl of Cork. And he suggested that one do something very odd, that you actually do an experiment. You do an experiment to understand nature. And he argued for the introduction of experiment, and since he was very wealthy, he acquired a device called an air pump. We will refer to this device probably today as a vacuum pump. What this device does is that it extracts air from a bell jar, which is the jar right in the center there. And what he did was he then proceeded to perform a number of experiments to understand the relationship between pressure and volume. And he made very strong arguments for the use of experiments. You might not imagine that this met with extreme ridicule. People wrote plays about this, saying that Boyle was attempting to weigh air. What a ridiculous concept. And so this argument for what we consider to be almost synonymous with science and scientific endeavor today, that is the use of experiments, was something that required a revolution of thought. Well, Boyle didn't do this only, he did not only perform the experiment, he literally wrote the book on how one is to become a scientist and how one is to perform as a scientist. So he wrote the book on the modality of the experiment. And he said in order to convince all the skeptics, one had to perform the experiment in front of credible witnesses. This is much the same as if one were to make an argument in a court of law, and to insert particularly in a criminal case, you would need lots of witnesses. And more so, it would be even better if those witnesses were people of stature that understood your experiment and could argue with you and interrogate the findings. He insisted that whenever you've completed the experiment, that your claim should be very modest. You should not exceed the results that you were observing. You should write it down plainly. You should write a very detached and accurate report. And the reason for doing this is writing the report was a very important part of the process, is that you would expand your circle of witnesses. You would have a multiplicity of witnesses, because others not present at the time of you doing the experiment would in fact be able to duplicate the experiment, and then that other witnesses would be there to see exactly what has happened. Moreover, he introduced the morality of the way we do science today, and that is he encouraged the diversity of views, he encouraged common folk who would probably be you and I, certainly be people like ourselves, to be witnesses and participate in the experiment. Because at that time, people undertaking these kinds of investigations were almost exclusively part of the aristocracy, because those are the people who could afford things like air pumps. And so he argued that this experimental philosophy should not only be for the privileged, but also just for the ordinary people. And when one had disputes, you should dispute the findings and certainly not the person. There should be no attack on personalities, but you should interrogate very clearly the findings of the experiment. The tone of your discussion in the philosophical controversy should be civil, and it should be liberal. So these were the tenets, if you like, of what we consider to be the way we do science today. So all of this happened, and it was made possible with the establishment of the Royal Society in 1662. When this happened, there was a place where natural and experimental philosophers could come in together and perform experiments and discuss it and write up their findings. And eventually, in 2 years later, scientific journals were written reporting the discussions of the fellows of the Royal Society. And in fact, the motto of the Royal Society remains today, nullius in verbia, means take no man's word for it. So the transition from natural philosopher to experimental philosopher to scientist was then complete, and hence the birth of the scientific method. So just to refresh your memory, I remember how one should give a good first year lecture, and that is to say the same thing over and over and over again in one lecture. So I'll be doing that. Firstly, there's an observation, and there's a careful set of experiments, and the combination of the observation and the careful set of experiments would result in a theory, a mathematical theory, and using that theory, one would then make a prediction. So I've asked my three-year-old son, Joshua, who's a budding scientist, I hope, to illustrate this. So Joshua went along and he stepped on one of his ping pong balls, and to his dismay, the ball deformed. What really happened, he explained, was the ball lost its volume. The volume decreased after applying some pressure. So he, even though that affected him severely, he was unhappy about that. He performed the experiment nonetheless over and over again, pressing at the ping pong ball, applying the pressure, decreasing the volume, and knowing that there's this relationship between pressure and volume, also noting that the temperature in the room did not change. And so he wrote out the theory. Joshua was actually discovering or rediscovering the gas laws. So you notice that there's an inverse relationship between pressure and volume. If you increase the pressure, the volume should decrease. And this happened at constant temperature, so all of the those three variables, relationship between them, would remain constant. And then he thought, well, now I can make a prediction. If I increase the temperature, then the pressure and the volume, which should also be then constant, something should happen there. And I suggest, and as he said to me, that the volume should be recovered. So he summoned me to the kitchen where I got some boiling water. And then he performed this experiment. So there you see, that's a scientific method. So as brilliant as a scientist as that Joshua may be, or is, will turn out to be, let's return to Boyle. One of the things that Boyle did do is that he decided to align the theory of chemistry with the current theories that were developing in physics. And that is the Isaac Newton was a big proponent of the corpuscular theory of light, saying that light consists of a series of particles. And so Boyle thought that it'd be good to align chemistry with that theory and think of the way we make or we understand the material world. We should think of them in terms of small, indivisible units. And he referred to those as elements. He was way ahead of his time because the first publication on elements, on the first study elements, was done 100 years later. And only 200 years after Boyle's coining of the term elements was the periodic table, which every chemist will flash in front of you if you just ask them any question at once. But I'm not going to go into the details of this periodic table. I would like you to think of the periodic table as a set of Lego blocks, right? You can get blue ones, red ones, green ones, and this might represent hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, and so forth, all the different elements on the periodic table. And then if you were to link them together, you would make molecules. As you would, much in the same way, as you were to link Lego blocks together, you would make different kinds of structures. So you could start off by making very simple structures, the simple Lego blocks, or you could make more complicated structures with very specialized pieces. And here is my favorite character, the Batman's Batmobile. You can see you can make such complicated structures. Much in the same way, you can take some elements and put them together and make a very simple molecule. By itself, it's simple. Together as an aggregate, it's very complicated, but water is simply just an oxygen and two hydrogens. Or you could make a much more elaborate molecule, and this is referred to as a oligosaccharide or glycan if you were a biologist, or a molecular biologist. And you can see here these are specialized pieces that you've got here. You've got all these, some kind of repeating of what looks sort of the same to the untrained eye. And these are all little carbohydrate units making up this very complex molecule. So if one thinks of the atomic elements as Lego bricks with which chemists put together very complex systems called molecules. But the forming of molecules is at the heart of chemistry. The making of molecules is what chemists are mostly focused on. The making of novel molecules that affects our society, both as in new materials that might be made or in biological systems. But I'm a computational and theoretical chemist, and so the way I think of the world is I think of how much energy is required to make a molecule, and is it possible to have that molecule made? And so now I'm going to attempt to explain something to you which our second year students never get, And if at the end of it you do get it, I implore you to approach Professor Bourne, who's the head of the chemistry department, and ask for your credit in chemistry, physical chemistry, at the second year level. So, what happens? Mostly the molecules around you, they're moving all the time. So they're bouncing all the time. And if I wanted to make a connection between, let's say in this case, two red Lego blocks, and they're moving about all the time, the question is, what would the chances be that these two red Lego blocks would make a collision? So that's a random process, and that we generally refer to as entropy. It's something that prevents us from actually getting to the goal of making the two Lego blocks join up constantly. On the other hand, there's also the idea, imagine for some reason I've managed to isolate those two red Lego blocks, and I've managed to click them together. There's an amount of energy that goes into actually driving them towards each other. And so the combination of this energy that's required to actually make those two molecules click, subtracting away the wasteful energy that just goes about when they're just moving around, hoping that eventually they'll bang into each other, makes up for useful energy. Or we can think of it as the work needed to make molecules. So if you get that, Professor Bourne, I don't know where you are, hopefully there'll be lots of people knocking on your door. Now, we can't just leave this to chance, and we can't just hope that reactions happen. And what nature does is that nature uses catalysts. And they call these catalysts very special names, and we call them enzymes. And so what an enzyme does is that, firstly, instead of just having the molecules bounce around, or like the Lego blocks are just sort of bouncing around randomly, a catalyst restricts the volume or the space with which the two molecules there that you may want to have react can be. So in this case, you can see these two Lego blocks is in a little pipe now, and so now the chances of them knocking up against each other is greatly increased. They're not just out there mixed up with red and green and blue and green and black Lego blocks. They're now just the two of them. But as you can see, they're still not clicking together. So they're bouncing up and down, but they're still not clicking together. So the other thing that a catalyst does is that it gently guides together, if it were forming a bond, gently guides together the two red Lego blocks, and then it makes a click, and a bond is formed, and the reaction is complete. And that's what a catalyst does. It lowers the energy for reaction to take place. Now, if I were to say that I now, for the traditional tools of the scientific method, I would say, let's go ahead and let's perform an experiment to see if we can observe an enzyme reaction inside an enzyme catalyzed reaction. Well, firstly, that's a very difficult thing to do, because an enzyme is a very complicated molecular system, and to burrow right inside the enzyme and to actually to look and see what's going on there is not feasible at the moment with experiments. And that is partly because the size of a molecule, it's incredibly small. It's 1/1,000,000th of a meter small. So I would need a camera that could take a picture of something that's 1/1,000,000th of a meter small. I would then have to get a video machine or some video device to record this entire event, and the video device has to have a frame rate that's small enough to take to monitor an event of the chemical reaction which happens at a speed of 1/1,000,000th of 1/1,000,000,000th of a second. So, firstly, let's look at our microscopes. Our best optical microscope are limited to observing objects that are 250 billionth of a meter in size. That's 250 times too weak to just look at the molecules participating in the chemical reaction inside the enzyme. Secondly, if we manage to do that, our fastest camera, which has been a paper that was published in the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences just this year, has a shutter speed of 1/1,000,000th of 1/1,000,000th of a second. That's 1,000 times too slow. So what do we do? We have the traditional tools of the scientific method at our disposal. We've got some observation. We can see something happening, and we're trying to perform an experiment, but we don't have the tools with which to perform the experiment. But do we? Well, there are computers. So the very first idea of a computer started in 1812 with Charles Babbage. And he observed a set of logarithmic table and noticed lots of mistakes in it. And then he came to the realization that one can actually build a machine that can do this kind of computation. Of course, there's been many advances in computing. The very first programmable computer was made in the 1930s. The first programming language to the dread of computer scientists, this Fortran, was developed in the 1950s. And in 1960, as far as chemistry goes, prominent scientists, some of which I'm very pleased is here, Professor Fritz Schaefer, is a key developer of different kinds of methods to understand the orbits and the shapes and the movement of electrons. John Popel got the Nobel Prize for this work. He was featured as the chief proponent of this development of various techniques. Norman Ellinger was also at the University of Georgia, from which Professor Schaefer hails, developed methods to look at larger systems, molecules, and he used models like balls and springs to describe molecular systems. Anasuya Raman at the Argonne National Laboratory in Chicago developed dynamic methods, which are principally known as the molecular dynamic method, to make these molecules move. And then Michel Paranello in 1985 with his colleague Carr wrote a paper showing how one can not only make the molecules, the actual atoms move, but also make the electrons move. Martin Field and Paul Bash and Martin Karplis at Harvard University developed a method which allowed us to look at the dynamics of electrons and molecules inside enzymes. So when I joined the University of Cape Town, I felt that I should do something about understanding chemical reactions. But this is a very difficult thing to do right off the bat. And so I first focused my mind on trying to understand the shapes of complex molecules. And that is trying to calculate the useful energy that describes the shapes of molecules in solvents like water. And I chose to look at carbohydrates because my previous mentor then was John Brady, and he was the leading expert in the classical modeling of carbohydrate systems. And so I applied this method with him, and we calculated the shape of a complex carbohydrate molecule in water. A few years later, I took a sabbatical and went to the University of Minnesota, and with Jelly Gao, I showed that this method of calculating the useful energy can be applied to simple chemical reactions. Now, what you'll see here is a chemical reaction, and there's I draw your attention to this yellow bond over here, and you'll see that this will get snapped, and a red little bond over there will get formed. Now, I've just drawn your attention to that, but when this happens, as you can see, lots of things are going on. I've just represented the enzyme here as a green mass. So I've taken away all the details and said there's lots of things going on, but you can see just the flickering in the background tells you that there's a lot of activity. There's a lot of activity within this molecule itself that the enzyme is acting on. And so you can think of this as a very complex event. I would like to think you think of this as you witnessing a car crash in a mountainous region with a winding road that's filled with lots of traffic, lots of things going on. The sun shining through the trees, there's lots of cars overtaking each other, and suddenly there's the collision and two cars crash into each other. Now, if you were the witness to this event, and somebody said to you, please explain what has happened. The presiding police officer came up to you and said, you witnessed this accident, tell me what happened. But before you go on, you're only allowed to draw a straight line on a line, and then you can represent the cars as little balls, and then you can tell me exactly what happened. So just draw on this line over here and explain to me exactly what happened. You can imagine this is a very difficult thing to do, or I would say almost impossible. Lots of things were going on. And how can you explain these, all these complex motions in just a simple line drawing? You can imagine that it would be much better if you were given the option of introducing other dimensions, waving your hands and showing the officer how the cars crashed. And this is why we felt that there was a need to develop a multidimensional free energy system to describe chemical reactions. And this is what we did. I did this with a former student of mine, Johan Strumfer, who has now left science and is working for Google. So there's a pathway from chemistry to Google instead of the other way around. So this drew quite a bit of attention. The editors of the journal decided to put it on its front cover because of the significance of this work. Later on last year was the Year of Chemistry. The United Nations called this the Year of Chemistry, and all kinds of celebrations was going on all around the world. We ourselves here in the chemistry department had a series of lectures organized by the then head of the department, Alan Rogers. But I was invited by the Academy of Sciences in China to write one of 32 papers that were being solicited from scientists around the world in the journal Science China. So we were the only African, that was the only African contribution to that collection. And I believe it's because this work caught the attention of the then editors. Later on, I was also asked by the editors of the Royal Society's journal, Physical Chemistry, Chemical Physics, to write also on this multidimensional method and its application to numerous problems in chemistry, particularly to chemical reactions. So let's see, with all this development of this techniques, these computational techniques, the question is, can one really apply this to interesting and useful problems? And that's always the question that's asked to scientists. So this is very nice that you can all do all these calculations and you can use up all these this computer time, but what does all of this mean? And so if one were to look at the human body, right, and one were to just think of all the molecules in the human body, you'd see that most of it, and I think you all know this, is mostly water, and water is a solvent in which lots of these other molecules, these important biomolecules, are bathed in. That's proteins and lipids and carbohydrates. And you will notice that there's a great concentration on proteins and the structures of proteins by biochemists and biophysicists. Those of us in science, we see this enormous concentration on proteins and relatively little attention being paid to lipids and carbohydrates. Or one may think of them as sugars. Well, why is that? Well, simply, proteins seem to be more proteins in your body than anything else. And if you want to think of the way proteins are made, firstly, let's start off with one's genes. Right? So you start off with your genes, and you know that from your genes you get DNA, and DNA can be transcripted to RNA, so deoxyribonucleic acid, and ribonucleic acid, to give you the correct term, but most people will probably recognize DNA and RNA. And from that, from this, if you like, manual, right, that's what your genes are, this manual, you can make lots of proteins, and that's called translation, that step over there. So once you have your genes, the genes tell you how to make a whole lot of proteins. And that's collectively all the proteins in the system is referred to as the proteome. So everybody then went about trying to discover what the genomes were of various systems. They started off by looking at the genome of a single cell. And that is, there's, and they found that there's 6,000 genes in a single cell. The next step up was to look at a more complex system, a multicellular system. This is a hermaphrodite, C. elegans, a worm. And there's 16,000 genes in this system. So that's not too bad. There's an increase of 10,000 genes, even though there's it's a very complex system compared to the simple yeast cell. And if you wanted to look at the fly, 20,000 genes in a fly, well, a fly's pretty complicated. It's only an increase of about 4,000 genes. And then a human only has 26,000 genes. Now that's not very satisfying. I mean, you've got Albert Einstein, he's only got 6,000 more genes than a fly. So when the human genome, the publications for the human genome was written up, one of the big leaders in the field, Craig Fenter, wrote in his publication, the finding that the human genome contains fewer genes than previously predicted might be compensated for by combinatorial diversity generated at the levels of post-translational modification of proteins. So let's go back to what we think of genes and proteins. So you start off with genes, RNA, DNA, so you've got your map book of how to make proteins. You translate all of that, you make the proteins, and then there's other steps. There's post-translational steps that happen to the protein. A major post-translational step is something called glycosylation, in where the protein has the addition of a carbohydrate, a complex carbohydrate, onto its system. So, okay, this is very nice, but why is this important? Well, let's look at a cell. So there you've got a cell, and the cell takes in simple sugars, right? Simple carbohydrates, takes them in, right? There's waiting all these proteins that have already been made, pre-made by the information gotten from the genes, and then these monosaccharides are then assembled, or these simple sugars are then assembled, and then they get added onto these proteins, and they're assisted by an enzyme catalyst called a series of enzymes called glycosyl transferases. So glycosyl transferases, this enzyme, as I said to you before, helps this reaction to happen, this complex set of reactions to happen. These glycoproteins then migrate to the surface of a cell, and then they act as antenna, where they communicate with other cells. They communicate with other normal cells, and they also communicate, unfortunately, with other cells that we don't like, and that is bacteria, for example. So when you get some infection, this is how it happens. Bacteria starts interfering with your normal communication of your cells and stop doing that, and similarly viruses. So a lot of your diseases can be tacked down to this interference and this communication that happens at that level with your cell. So the carbohydrates, if you like, are the communicators, the antenna that sit at the surface of the cell. Here you have a picture of the red blood cell. And all of these sort of hairy bits that you see hanging off there, these are complex carbohydrates. And these complex carbohydrates look something like that. Remember the picture that I showed you right in the beginning, the equivalent of the Batmobile? That's what it looks like, and that's a big determining factor about which tells you what kind of blood type you are, whether you're O, A, B, or AB. The other thing that has happened is that we've realized that right on the surfaces of all these very complex, horrible viruses that comes into our system, for example, the HIV virus, it's a sheath of very thick oligosaccharides, complex carbohydrates. And so if we can break the defense of these complex carbohydrates on the HIV virus, for example, we can develop something that can interfere with the virus's immune system and then kill it off. Another area is cancer, or the biology of cancer. What happens there is that the cancer cell, the tumor develops, and there's a modification of the carbohydrates on the surface of the tumor cell, which prevents your normal antibodies from attacking the tumor and effectively wiping it out, and that's how it continues to grow inside your body and breaking and evading your immune system. So the National Academy of Sciences was commissioned by the National Science Foundation in the United States, the NIH, which is the National Institutes of Health and the Department of Energy and a series of other funding bodies to investigate the future of the glycosciences and the effects that it would have. And they concluded that glycoenzymes and glycoenzyme inhibitors will be driving the progress of many areas in science. And glycoconjugate structures and recognition, metabolism, and biosynthesis will be a very high priority and should be a very high priority for the NSF and the NIH and the DOE. And I hope that the NRF and the Department of Science and Technology is listening to this. We can put it on and send it to them, and maybe they'll also follow suit. But principally, what was mentioned is that two of the five techniques that they felt needed a focus on in order to solve this problem was molecular modeling and informatics. So I'm going to focus on something that the Department of Energy in the United States focuses on quite a lot, and that's the race to. This is one of the examples of things that we work on in my laboratory, and that's the race to find a renewable source of energy, and that's something that one might get from cellulose. Now, cellulose is a very long carbohydrate molecule in general. It's a long chain of very simple sugars, simple carbohydrates, and it's found in agricultural waste. It's found in the grass that you cut when you mow your lawn, the trees, all over the place, which is referred to as the biomass. It's the most abundant molecule, organic molecule in the biomass. And from this, if you manage to break up cellulose, you can break it up into a small unit, and from that you can get ethanol and biofuel. So you can see why there's a big focus in the United States on chasing after the renewable source of energy. Okay, so how do you break up a complex molecule like cellulose? Well, why don't we take our clues from nature? Let's observe what nature does. Here you can see this is a tree and it's decaying. So why is it decaying? Well, it's decaying because it's being attacked by a fungus, Trichoderma ricei. And how does that fungus work? So that's the, if you like, the molecular biology question about identifying the fungus. If you're a chemist, you want to know exactly how does this work. Well, the way that works is there's a glycosidase, a special enzyme that goes along the cellulose structures and rips up a piece of cellulose and breaks off pieces at the end. But you can see it's ripping it up there and breaking off pieces at the end. But as a chemist, you'd want to know exactly what the details of that is. But as I said before, experimentally, this is very difficult to understand, so one needs computational techniques. A few years ago with my ex-student, who's now in the computer science department and has Hans' own group, Michelle Cattell, she ran an experiment which simulated an atomic force microscopy experiment. So she ran a computer experiment, which is this blue curve over here, that simulated an actual experiment. And what this experiment does is that it takes a long molecule and it pulls it along. So it pulls it and it sees at which point does it give. Much if you were to take a pick and bay plastic bag and you were to draw on it, at some point you'd see it gives, right? And there's irreversible change. So you pull it and it suddenly releases, and then you keep on pulling it and it'll do it again. That's what all these little bumps in this curve mean. And so there are significant events that happen at each one of these bumps. And we published this in the Journal of American Chemical Society, and we showed that the computational model was validated since we could explain and show exact replication of the experimental result. So we went on and we thought, well, if you keep on pulling this, there's a deformation of rings, all these little carbohydrate units made up of rings. And so we developed a method with my then student, Christopher Barnett, a method to calculate the deformation of a ring inside a molecular system. How much energy does it take to bend and twist a molecular ring? Well, this turned out to be quite important because the way we calculated and tried to understand the chemical reaction in this very important enzyme that rips off pieces of cellulose at the end was to see that what this enzyme really does is that it takes this very long chain of cellulose molecules and, like a wrestler, it bends it into a very awkward position. So it bends its ring just before it gets it to submit and crack. So you can imagine the kind of stress that that molecule is under. And then it goes off and performs the chemical reaction. So grips it into its space, twists it, and then it pulls and tugs at it, as you can see over here. It pulls and tugs at it, and then it knocks off. Right at the end, it knocks off the tail end of the molecule. And that is only possible. It's only possible to observe this, as you can see the tail going off there. It's only possible to observe this by doing a computer experiment. And we published this too in the Journal of the American Chemical Society. Now, that enzyme doesn't work very efficiently. Unfortunately, at some point it collapses and it doesn't continue to work. And so the question is, can we look at this enzyme and re-engineer it and modify it and see if we can do better than what nature has done? So can we succeed where the enzyme has failed? Well, in the words of a very famous politician, yes, we can. Right. So what is shown here is not our work. This is a very important paper. It's a paper by a collaboration between computational scientists. The computational scientist said, why don't we take an enzyme in nature and get this enzyme to perform a reaction that is not possible in nature? And this is a very important reaction for organic chemists. And I'm not going to go into the details of that reaction. This is a Diels Alder reaction. So they looked at the innards of this enzyme and said, if you make certain modifications to this enzyme, you can make this enzyme perform this particular reaction, which nature does not do. And the reason why that's attractive is because enzymes are extremely efficient. When organic chemists perform reactions, they have, at the end of their series of steps, they have very low yields. But when an enzyme does it, it has 100% yield. So there's no wastage. So this is what you want to do. You want to get the enzyme to perform a chemical reaction. So they got this enzyme and called it Diels Alderase, which does not exist in nature. And this was published in the journal Science in 2010. So to recap, this is unfortunately a picture of myself when I was in a laboratory many years ago doing an MSc in experimental science. And as you can see, I had lots of hair at the time. But this process of moving from experiment to theory makes you lose your hair. So what can I conclude from what we've just seen here tonight? And that is that computational science, computational experiments, is reshaping the scientific method. It can do things that experiments cannot do. So if you start off with an observation, you might develop a computational model. You will perform some experiments. The model can be validated by repeating some of the results that one gets from experiment. You can then perform a computer experiment, which is not possible to do experimentally. You can then develop a theory, come up with a prediction, and if possible later, perform an actual experiment to see that that's correct. There's a picture of Linus Pauling here, pointing at a model. This is a physical model. But you can do much better with a computational model than you can do with a physical model. And so this is an argument by computational scientists, much like Boyle has argued many years ago, in the face of lots of resistance from theoreticians, that one should introduce an experiment into the scientific method. This is an argument to introduce computational simulations into the scientific method to understand nature. So, what I want to do now is give you the condensed version of what I just said to you. And so I'll just review very quickly in about less than 3 minutes exactly what we did, what I said to you about studying biofuels. Exciting day in the lab like that every day, and it's due very much to many of the fantastic students that I've had through my career at the University of Cape Town. Oliver Hill was my first PhD student, which I shared with John Moss. Michelle Cattell was my very own PhD student, and she's now an associate professor in the computer science department. Robert Best did a master's in the year as a lecturer at Cambridge University. And I can go on. These students are absolutely amazing. They're very talented. And the people doing a lot of the work that you've seen here tonight is particularly Christopher Barnett, Johan Strumpfer, Kyle Fernandez has done quite a bit of the GPU processing work. And I could not do a lot of what I do without the great and wonderful assistance of Louise Besaidenhout. I've also been very, very, very lucky to collaborate with a number of wonderful colleagues in the chemistry department, Gerard Venter, Tim Egan, David Gammon, Klaas Koch, who was then at UCT and is now migrated to the other side, and that's he's gone to Stellenbosch, Anwar Jardine, and the late John Moss. Those are the people that I hopefully have influenced, and these are the people that have influenced me, and they're my late wife Stella Clark, my postdoc supervisor John Brady, my PhD supervisor taught me how to program, Jürgen Schnittke, my wonderful children, Jesse, Eamon, Joshua, who was the great experimenter, and Ella, and my wonderful wife, Claire, and my parents, who, of course, without them, I would certainly not be here. So, one last thing, this is a revolution, and this is probably where the computational revolution started. This is just taken a few blocks away from the house that I grew up in, and this is not me. But it shows you, this picture was eventually made it to the front cover of the Cape Times and then the front cover of Time magazine. And you can see what happens if you offer too much resistance. You eventually have to give in. Thank you very much.